broadcasting the information the mainstream media won't touch. This is the Richie Allen Show in association with DavidIke.com.
Let's welcome our next guest to the program. She was on the show back in February of this year, and we were delighted to have her. She's a former US intelligence asset, and she worked as a backdoor channel on anti-terrorism from 1993 to 2003. She warned, her team warned, about a major terrorist attack involving airplane hijackings and a strike on the World Trade Center, but they were ignored. And that would eventually have serious consequences for her personally. She's the author of the brilliant Extreme Prejudice, The Terrifying Story of the Patriot Act, and the cover-ups of 9/11 and Iraq. It's great to welcome back to the programme, Susan LIndauer. Susan, welcome back to the show. How are you?
I'm doing great. We're having an adventure in America right now.
Oh, you're having lots of fun.
I'm so excited you called.
You're having lots of fun, right? What with presidential debates and elections and news today about flight MH17. Do you sometimes think, Susan, that in a cycle like this, you might be better off leaving the country for a few months?
Oh, I'm enjoying it. I'm right in the middle of it.
You're having fun, right?
Listen, America is in the fight of our century. And I realize that a lot of people right now in Europe are being fed a lot of baloney information, a lot of garbage information about Donald Trump versus Hillary Clinton. And it seems like you're all being told that Hillary Clinton is this responsible, steady, trustworthy, knowledgeable person versus Trump, who is inexperienced and brash and bombastic. But I want to tell you that you've got it exactly backwards. Hillary is the most dangerous woman on the planet, and I'm going to show you why Trump, you should all be praying and rooting, cheering for Trump, and I am fighting as hard as I can to help him get elected now.
Right. Now, I love this, but I'm going to tell you, you're absolutely right. Your characterization of Hillary Clinton couldn't be any more spot on. It's right on, Susan. I couldn't argue with you. But it's my contention, and we didn't bring you on to argue with you. We're not going to argue with you.
I love a good argument.
Yeah, I know you love a good argument. I get to have my say quite a lot on the programme, so I don't have to keep ramming my opinion down the throats of my listeners. But it's my contention, Susan, that the choice that you have there is no choice at all. Ultimately, even though your characterisation of Clinton is absolutely right on, Trump is an establishment stooge as well, isn't he? He must be.
Well, actually, I have been surprised. He is a wealthy billionaire, but I'll give you several different examples of why every one of us should take a deep breath of relief for Trump's, because Trump surprises you when you start digging into his record. Trump opposed the Iraqi war before the invasion, and actually went on television. This is what I first became aware of him. And I had forgotten a lot of this. I was the chief CIA asset who covered the Iraqi embassy. And Trump was one of the only voices in political life who could actually get on Fox News and CNN, who was big enough to go on CNN and Fox News, who was out there saying, this is insane. Give the weapons inspections a chance to work. Cooperate with the United Nations. Do not go it alone. Do not try to force the world into this war. There's no reason to do this. And so from a long period, 15 years, he has always been consistently opposed to using the U.S. military as the police of the world. He has I'm speaking now, this should make everybody so relieved who's in Europe and the Middle East. Trump deeply opposes U.S. military intervention.
So he's anti-interventionist, Susan. That's what you think.
Yes. And that's good. Believe me, that is such an improvement.
Who could argue with that? And I'm not going to argue with it. Why did Trump say...
Well, the other thing I want to say is about 9/11. And this also surprises people that on the day of September 11th, 2001, on that very day, Trump called it out and he said there had to be bombs and explosives to bring down the building. He even said there had to be a bomb in the basement of the building in order to bring it down. And he described visiting the World Trade Center while it was under construction and the positioning of the steel girders and how highly reinforced reconstruction this was. And there's no way that a plane crashing into this, no way a plane could crash into the building and penetrate into the building. It would break apart on contact with the building.
Tell me this, Susan, is there, I'm not doubting you for a second now, we love what you do, but I'm going to be the devil's advocate. Is there a record of Trump saying those things somewhere?
Yes, and I'll be happy to send it to you.
Yeah, look, I'm not putting it up to you. I'm not challenging you.
That's okay.
I just want to know that because
I'll send you the video of it. It's like a minute. It's like 2 or 3 minutes that was on CNN, and I'll be happy to send that for your archives. The other thing that you guys should know is that he supports collaboration with Russia, and again, I know that Europe is like all twisted around right now about Russia and Ukraine and Syria. But he doesn't, you know, the United States must never put boots on the ground in the Middle East again. And if please God, Trump wins in November, the United States is going to stop financing the rebels in Syria. They're going to stop sending military weapons, stop training them, stop covering for them, and that means the Syrian war will take a huge step towards conclusion and completion. And once the Syrian war is, please God, let it be over, those refugees who are flooding into Europe could go home. And that is going to be a huge relief for Europe, I think.
Do you think, Susan, in all your experience, and I'm going to go back to Trump in a second, do you think that there's a good argument to be made that one of the deliberate intended consequences of the carnage in Syria was to basically create fear and divide and conquer in Europe by flooding Europe with mostly, God love them, mostly desperate people who have been bombed out of their homes and their land? Do you think that was an intended consequence because of what's coming down the line to prevent opposition to the very system that you've described so brilliantly in your book, you know, the people responsible for 9/11? Do you think that's part of the intended consequences, flooding Europe with migrants to create divide and rule?
Yes, to create divide and rule. And also they want they know there has to be a pressure release because Hillary Clinton, God help us all, wants to declare war on Iran and Lebanon. She is not happy that she has only got her wars in Iraq, Syria, and Libya. She is actually championing new wars with Lebanon and Iran. And especially poor Lebanon, which just breaks my heart, because Lebanon is an easy target. Just like, and Lebanon is doing a brilliant job holding together respect for their, it's respect and tolerance for all the different religions, all the different sects, just like Syria was doing before the war. But Lebanon is seething with refugees already, and it will explode again. That's what Hillary wants to do. That's why she's saying, she's promising Europe that she will take, that the United States will take an extra 500,000 refugees.
That's right. Yeah.
And that's why the European government, that's what you all need to understand. Hillary Clinton is promising to take an extra 500,000 refugees into the United States, which I'm sure all of you would say, oh, thank God, please, America, take them. But the problem is, the reason why she wants to take the refugees is she wants to start all new wars, which are going to create even more problems than we've already got.
Now, I believe, by the way,
who wants to end, he's like, no, we're going to support Russia's position. We're going to stop sending military weapons to these these jihadists. We're going to stop financing them. We're going to stop protecting them. We're going to cut them off. And when that happens, the war will, you know, Assad and Russia will be able to take control of the situation. And once that war winds down, the Syrian refugees will stop flooding into Europe, and those that are already there can go home.
Now,
a lot of them want to go home.
Let me put something to you.
Want to live in Europe? I mean, no offense.
Of course, they don't. No, they
don't want to be there.
No, their heart and their souls are in their land and where they came from. Let me put this scenario to you, Susan. Look, Hillary Clinton and her husband are the devil incarnate. Nobody would argue with that. Now, you're talking to our audience on the Richie Allen Show on davidicke.com and elsewhere. We're well briefed on who Hillary Clinton and her husband and the Clinton Foundation and all of that. We know who they are. But you're absolutely right. The vast majority of people who get their news from BBC and Sky and Channel 4, they are of the opinion that Hillary is a wonderful woman who's going to be a wonderful president. We know she isn't. But I want to talk a little bit about Trump again and some of the things that Trump has said. What really disturbed me about Trump was something he said, and I know what you're going to do now. Well, maybe you won't, but a lot of people do it. They say, you know, he just shoots from the hip. He doesn't pay attention to what he says. But when he was asked about Edward Snowden, he strongly implied, Susan, that if it was left up to him, Snowden would face capital punishment. He's not fit to be president of the United States, surely. And you're a whistleblower. Oh, you're one of the most famous whistleblowers that I've spoken to in recent years. So you could be in line for the
so
gas
much.
Chamber. No, you are. But under Trump, under Trump's rules, you've betrayed the country, so you should go to the chair.
Well, now, whistleblowers, Trump is not against whistleblowers. The problem that Edward Snowden faces is that he ran to America's enemies, and his actions, unfortunately, right at the beginning, he went to China. He went to Hong Kong and had meetings with Chinese intelligence, and he tried to get Chinese intelligence to give the files from the NSA to Chinese intelligence. And then, unfortunately, he did run to Russia, and he did give it to Russian intelligence as well. I wish he did not do that. That was the kind of thing that any government in the world, unfortunately, would see him as a traitor on that basis. But what he did is so valuable and necessary that we have to overlook that. But giving it to the end, that's the problem with what he did. Whistleblowers, I think that WikiLeaks and Julian Assange, I think, has a very good shot at having his charge, his criminal investigation that's been hanging over him all this time. I will be arguing that on behalf of Julian Assange, I will gladly argue in any correspondence that I ever have with Trump that Julian Assange needs to be deified. That Julian Assange, I may not be able to protect Edward Snowden, but I've already made a commitment to help Julian Assange.
Yeah.
And I may not be able to do anything for Edward Snowden because what I just said about Hong Kong and Russia.
I would argue now, Susan. Let me back in. Sorry to interrupt you. Let me back in. I would argue now.
Some of these others and Bradley Manning. Julian Assange and please Bradley Manning. Those are the two that I'm going to be fighting for.
Well, let me back in, because even if that's the case, that Snowden blotted his own copybook by going to the Far East and meeting with, intelligence agencies there, Snowden could argue, well, what else was I going to bloody well do? I was in fear for my life. I knew the US intelligence agencies were chasing me, and all I did was release some videos, amongst other documents that showed, amongst a lot of documents that showed how tyrannical my country was, how tyrannical it was behaving. Trump shouldn't be saying stuff like that, Susan. It speaks, I think, to his psychopathy to say that, you know, a guy who basically blew the whistle on serious wrongdoing by his government should be in line for capital punishment. It's not good enough, I would say.
Yeah, I I understand. I understand. Because I love what Edward Snowden did and what William Binney did before him to show the heavy surveillance, the blanket massive surveillance of the United States government against the freedom of the essential freedoms. This is what makes America ourself, our country. It makes us our heart. Is the freedom that we believe we have and the privacy which we believe we have. And now, thanks to Edward Snowden, we know that they can turn on our telephones and watch us have sex. And seriously, and they do.
Smart technology is all about spying on us. It is,
my friend. It's really pretty ugly. So I think that there needs to be. I can tell you that I will be fighting for both Julian Assange and Bradley Manning. Bradley Manning to be pardoned, and Julian Assange to be to end any criminal investigation against him. But I don't know that I can do anything for Snowden.
I'm glad you mentioned.
Everybody's going to listen to me, but those are the two that I'm going to be fighting for.
Well, a lot of activists around the world know all about you, and they will certainly be listening to you. So don't do yourself down, as we say here in the UK. Moving away from Trump, we will come back to him a bit shortly, because I am going to go after you again about Trump. I believe that.
Sure.
This friend of Israel stuff and this nonsense.
That is the Israel question is...
It's a massive question.
That is a massive question. And Trump's daughter, Ivanka, converted to Judaism.
Right.
And she has a wonderful husband. And apparently they have a very happy marriage. And of course, that is what really comes down to. But he met with Bibi Netanyahu this past week at Trump Tower for 90 minutes, and they came out shaking hands. And it's a little bit you have to kind of gulp, oh dear, what's going to happen now? He said that he would make Jerusalem the capital of Israel, and that kind of makes me a little scared.
He's ultimately playing for the same team as Hillary Clinton, as we've come to call her. That's what I believe. And I'm going to say this, not about you, Susan. I'm not going to impugn you at all. But a lot of independent media outlets in America, people we like a lot, and we still like them, it doesn't matter. I think they've been coloured so much by their understandable hatred of Hillary Clinton that they've forgotten that ultimately the establishment presents us with our choices every time. They've forgotten that. And rather than saying to people, the solutions are not at the ballot box, which is what we always believed, that the solutions are in civil disobedience and supporting people like you when people like you come along and say what it is that you said. Rather than doing that, they've suddenly gone back to, we can change things through the ballot box if we vote for the Donald. And I think it's coloured by that hatred of Hillary.
The establishment is, if you watch the establishment news media every night, they bombard us with how terrible he is, how much they hate him. And it has really been backfired on them, because the more they say they hate him, the more the rest of us love him.
And I think that's deliberate as well.
We hate you. We, the American people, hate the establishment. And it has become a mark of we're proud deplorables. And that's not to say that we're in favor of racism. We are not in favor of racism. We don't consider ourselves to be racist or sexist. Hillary Clinton is saying that if you're a woman, it is sexist not to vote for her.
Pretty much.
But that's not how we see the world. We recognize that we want – I'd love to have a woman. I would love to have a woman president, but it can't be Hillary Clinton.
But not her.
Stands for.
You'd rather have Kim Kardashian as your president than Hillary Clinton. I'm hearing you loud and clear. I just want to give – imagine that and Kanye West in the White House. I just want to give a quick plug to Susan's book. It's Extreme Prejudice, The Terrifying Story of the Patriot Act and the Cover-Ups of 9/11 and Iraq. This lady and her team gave forewarning of planes attacking the eastern seaboard of the United States, and that it was coming in 2001, and they were ignored. The book is brilliant. I read it when it came out back in 2010, I think, 2011. I recommend it strongly. wrongly. Now, keep the tweets coming in. It's at Richie Allen Show on Twitter. You can email richie@richieallen.co.uk. We will go to Caroline in a couple of minutes' time for some tweets. But before we do that, Susan, I don't know if you've been following this today, but the Dutch-led investigation team looking into who or what and why the Malaysian flight MH17 was shot down, it concluded in its report today that all roads lead to Russia and that the missile was smuggled into eastern Ukraine from Russia and that Russia's fingerprints were all over it. Now, today they said...
Why would Russia try to shoot down?
Exactly. Well, Putin, take it away. Why?
Because they didn't.
End of story,
because
right?
They didn't. End of story. But I can see why. However, it could be that the Ukrainians had older Russian model supplies, military weapons, military hardware from Russia, and that would explain why this happened, why it is a Russian-made, because Ukraine possesses a lot of Russian-made weapons armaments. And so it's perfectly reasonable that it would be Russian-made and fired by Ukrainian soldiers. And they could have even done that quite deliberately. Because otherwise, why would Russia fire on Putin? They wouldn't.
One of your friends and colleagues is a regular on this program, Ray McGovern, former CIA analyst, like yourself.
Love Ray.
Great guy, Ray. We spoke about you before, actually, and we were chatting about you. Your ears must have been burning, Susan. But we've spoken quite a lot about this. And Ray said, timing is of the essence when these things happen. And of course, we had the Victoria Nuland-led coup in Ukraine, replacing Yanukovych, her and Yatsenyuk conspiring to get rid of the democratically elected Yanukovych. Poroshenko went in there. They moved Ukraine closer to the European Union. They moved it closer to NATO. They put a Chicago woman in, Natalie Jurescu, as their finance minister. It was an absolute coup. And of course, Russia were very...
Absolutely.
Wasn't it?
I
mean, how else would you describe it? What this was designed to do then, I'm gauging from what you're saying, is this was designed to basically cover up what they were doing there and throw all the spotlight on the evil red menace again, right? That's what
Absolutely.
It was about.
Absolutely. That's all it is. There's no way that Russia would fire on a plane with Putin traveling on it. That's ridiculous. It is, however, very plausible that the Ukrainians would fire on a plane that they thought was carrying Putin. And that's what happened, I'm sure.
We've got loads of tweets, understandably. We're going to go to Caroline now and get one or two tweets. Caroline is our social media monitor, and she's interacting with people on Twitter. We've had hundreds and hundreds of tweets tonight about fracking and about Susan and about Trump and about Clinton. Caroline, go ahead, take it away there.
Hello, Suzanne. The majority of the mood really with the tweets is that they're surprised to hear you, that you are ready to vote for Trump.
A lot of people say that.
They asked me to ask you, how could you vote for Trump? But they're also surprised that the US is being faced with only an impossible choice, really, which is actually either or. Hillary or Trump, both bad, but they seem to think it's a setup.
Hillary, I believe, is the most dangerous woman on the planet. She would like to be the president of the world. She has already threatened to use nuclear weapons against Russia or China and or Iran. She has promised wars with Iran and Lebanon. She is a catastrophe, as Libya and Syria and Ukraine show. She frightens the military and the intelligence people who have said that her policies create mistakes that only weaken the ability to solve problems. In other words, she will make strategic blunders and she refuses to listen to anybody. She's considered to be very dictatorial and arbitrary. And if anybody challenges her, she attacks them viciously and blisters them and just tirades, screaming tirades. She is not a calm, steady woman. She screams at the top of her lungs at her aides. They are terrified of her. They were so frightened of her during the email problem that they would break, they would take hammers and destroy her cell phones rather than, and her BlackBerry, rather than have confront her about the mistakes she was making. She has been caught stealing from the U.S. Treasury. She's really bad. She is a third world dictator, but she doesn't want to be dictator of the United States. She wants to be dictator of everybody, everywhere. And I consider it my obligation to stop her.
Any more, Caroline? Any more tweets there? No? Not for the minute. We'll be back with Caroline in a second. Thanks for that, Caroline.
I know it may surprise everybody, but I think that the questions of Trump's racism are overblown. I think that he does not like immigration. He doesn't. That's true. But Hillary, I consider that war is the ultimate racism. War is when you target other human beings for extermination based on their religion, their ethnicity, their national background. And war is where if Hillary's elected, there will be World War III. It will happen. And so I feel that that Trump's populism, he's going to focus more on the United States. And I think that's better for everybody.
You
may not like it. You may be hearing all kinds of awful things about him. But he wants to pull the money. He's going to have a strong military, but he wants to pull out of all the international conflicts. And he wants to focus on rebuilding the United States.
I worry, Susan.
So much better than the alternative.
I'll tell you what I worry about. I worry that while I believe that Trump personally holds some of the opinions that he expresses, I believe that. I'm not stupid. I really do believe that. But because of the nature of the man, because of his narcissism and his vanity, I think that an argument could be made that he would be putty in the hands of those who really control people like him. But I want to...
No, I think he's actually got... What I came to believe was that because of his opposition to the Iraq war, and because of his he was the first 9/11 truther, practically. Literally, when you see this video that I've just sent to you, I hope you'll post it in your archives, because what you'll see is that he on 9/11 he refused to back down, and he was right. And this is the thing, because he does have a large ego, he doesn't back down easily if he thinks he's right.
About Hillary and World War III, I'm delighted you brought that up, because a number of esteemed commentators in the alternative media are absolutely in agreement with you. They're convinced that a Hillary presidency will be immediately rubber stamped, or will immediately be kind of cemented by an escalation of things in Syria. In terms of a Hillary presidency will be, well, we need now to really send in our boys on the ground, and then you're going to have absolute carnage. And that might result in a protracted, heightened state of tension with Russia, and who knows where that might lead
to. She's already threatened war with Iran. We would definitely have boots on the ground. We definitely would have a conflict. And the thing about Hillary Clinton is she'll say anything to anybody that she has to make them leave her alone. So you have to look at her history and her actions. She defended George Bush on the war, on the Iraq war. All of the neocons who are backing her supported the Iraq war, and it's the Wolfowitz crowd. It's the same monsters who gave us the neocon mess to begin with. The Project for the New American Century, they're with Hillary, and that should scare everybody.
We have Susan LIndauer on the show, folks. We've got Susan for about another 5 minutes. Time is flying by. Susan, where can people find you online? Give a plug there.
I have my own radio show, Truth Frequency Radio, on Saturdays and Sundays from 4 to 6 p.m. London time.
Brilliant. I was going to mention that, but I was talking about a website, because the only website I could find is the one for Extreme Prejudice.
Extreme Prejudice, but I don't use that anymore. That hasn't been active for a while. But so, yeah.
Truth Frequency Radio on Saturdays and Sundays at 6 p.m. UK time, right?
Yes.
Fantastic. Yes. That's where you'll find Susan. Susan, when we talk about Third World War and the possibility of a conflict involving the United States and Britain and France maybe, and maybe Australia, and on the other side maybe China, Russia, and Iran, heaven forbid. I should have mentioned Israel, of course, on the side of the United States. When we mention this type of thing, when this sort of scenario comes up on the programme, I'm mindful of the fact that there are people whom are impressionable, and it really scares the living daylights out of them. And then we get accused then of fear-mongering. You know, you're
No. Yeah. Not with Hillary Clinton. If anything, I'm worried that most of you do not believe it, because it's too awful to contemplate that anybody would be this stupid to create World War III. But this is a woman who did not learn from Iraq when she went into Libya, and she did not learn from Iraq when she went into Syria. And she's a psychopath. She goes on, you know, in 2000, look at her videos from 2014 and 2015. Global Research Television has a brilliant compilation of her videos from March of 2015. And it is just scary to behold. She's laughing and just gleeful. Oh, yes, we're going to do it. She's even said that she would welcome a false flag so that she could go to war in the United States, so that she could go to war with Iran. And she said, bring it on. She used those words, bring it on. Let's get it on. Let's get it on. Come on. Let's get it on with it, so that we can have a false flag in the United States so she can have a war.
And blame
she's
Iran,
just
yeah.
stated matter-of-factly, if I am elected president, there will be war with Iran. And that just makes me just shiver. And that should scare you all to death. Because if you think we've got problems now, oh, my Lord, it's too terrifying. It's just awful to think of. And besides which, Iran, it doesn't matter whether you like someone's politics or not. We can all agree that we don't like Iran's politics. That does not give us the right to destroy the Iranian society.
No, you're right. You're right.
Iran. A lot of good people there who are trying to make their world a better place. And we have no right to go bomb their schools, their hospitals, their communities. Iran is a highly urban, modern, contemporary society. You know, what we did to the Iraqi people was hideous and unforgivable. And we had no right to do it.
And that was before the invasion, of course. You're talking about the sanctions that decimated the country. You know what I'm thinking, listening to you there? I'm thinking that you're quite right. We would have a lot of issues with the human rights record of certain, you know, parts of Iran, certain people in Iran. Of course, we should be concerned about that and we should condemn it. But I'm going to agree with you. In the 21st century world, we should be more concerned, and we should judge a country by how it treats its neighbours. What does it do? Is it offending its neighbours? Is it threatening the integrity and the sovereignty of its neighbours? And it isn't. The only countries in the world at the moment that are threatening the sanctity of the security of other nations are Great Britain, France, the United States, Israel, and there's a few others. But Turkey. The likes of Iran, Turkey, of course, Turkey and the Kurdish issue. But Iran has never, it's been hundreds of years since Iran has attacked or threatened to attack anybody.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And frankly, they have a good, peaceful Jewish community there that's very well protected.
Certainly do.
And they have, you know, there are some issues between the United States and Iran. And I, but I hope and pray that we can use diplomacy. And I think that the most important thing right now is to end the war in Syria. And I think that that hinges on the United States must stop supplying weapons, military training, and money to the rebels. And I am convinced that that's exactly what Donald Trump will do from his very first days in office. He will just cut them off. And he will make a collaborative effort with Russia to stop ISIS. And when we stop finance, when the United States stops paying for this, all of the men, not all the problems, many of the problems will stop and the war will wind down and the refugees will go home. That's what they want. They don't want to live in refugee camps. They want to go home. They really do.
Of course they do. They want to go back to their own land, their own families, their own space. Susan, we're just out of time. I want to give them a shout out again to truthfrequencyradio.com. That's where you'll find Susan's program, which airs every Saturday and Sunday at 6 p.m. UK time. It was about 7 or 8 months, Susan, between visits. Come back anytime you want. You're always welcome to come back
love
and chat
to.
With us. Love to get your opinion on these matters.
When we have after the election, we should do it because then we're going to be talking about what comes next for America. This is actually a very exciting moment.
Brilliant.
It really is.
Brilliant to chat with you. Thanks for doing it. Look after yourself. Once again, folks, Susan LIndauer, the book is Extreme Prejudice, the terrifying story of the Patriot Act and the cover-ups of 9/11 and Iraq. Susan, thank you.
Brilliant. Have a great week.
And you too, Susan. Susan LIndauer on the line to us there from her home in Maryland. Great stuff. Right.